The This Is a Concert Tour would have given people something to walk away with. It was incredible.
That's how I feel.
This time was very special because he knew that not only would it be a great opportunity for him to share his love of music and dance with his family and children, but he knew that his fans wanted it.
He would come up with a great idea and he would go, okay, now how can we do that better?
When you're dealing with the king of pop, it needed to go to another level.
Full-scale airplanes, bulldozers, and elevators. It ended up being the biggest of anything we'd ever done.
That's how Michael fought. You know, if you're not going to do it big, don't even think about it.
This is going to be his last go-around live. So there was never any doubt it was going to be Kenny working with Michael.
He wants a down tour.
I think Michael believed that I would make things happen and that he could trust me, that at the end of the day, what we were imagining together and building together, that I would take care of my part.
It came together in record time, and it was quite a thing to behold.
Go!
It's just amazing how close we came to having what would have been the greatest show ever.
Michael was really looking forward to getting out in front of a live audience again, because he did love that. I don't think he ever intended to take this much time in between tours.
He was a single parent, raising a family, which he loved. But he was writing all along. He was creating new music, but it took him a while to come back because he wanted to come back doing something that was going to excite him. There has to be a real reason for doing it and really invest the time. There has to be something there that makes it all important. And he kept saying to me, we'll know when it's it.
We were going to tour when his last album came out, but that was right when 9/11 happened. And every major artist canceled their tours, and Michael was one of them.
About 2 years ago, we were building a new arena in London, which was in and of itself an amazing feat because there's no land there, and that was called the O2. It's the most successful arena in the history of the arena business. The goal there was to go after a handful of worldwide superstars and convince them to residence there. And Michael was at the top of the list. I mean, it's a short list. So I pitched Michael 2 years ago, and I was summarily turned down. I was told he's really not ready at this time, and I kind of just gave up and said, okay, you know, maybe Michael will never play again.
AEG felt that the right thing for Michael to do was to go out and play public again and kind of reclaim his throne as the greatest live entertainer of all time. But at the first meeting, really what we were doing was telling Michael Jackson about our company and all the different assets that AEG had. And Michael got very excited about that. He was saying, you know, I really want to work with these guys.
Then early September of 08, I got a call from the gentleman who I work for. And he said Michael was actually ready to come back to work and he had asked for me. So I quickly went and met with Michael at the Bel Air Hotel. And it was really then that, looking him straight in the eye, I actually realized this was not a wild goose chase, that he really was ready to go back on stage. I asked him, Mike, why now? And he said something very kind of a peek into his soul. He said, you know, my kids are old enough now to appreciate what I do, and I'm still young enough to do it. And I think that motivated him even more than the money.
I could hear it in his voice. And he said to me, this is it. And he said that a couple of times. And I said to him, you should call it that. And a few weeks later, he was doing a press conference, and I saw that.
Michael Jackson's here. Go straight on stage. It will be a 3-minute video and a bit of talk from German. So that's enough time to ring the bell.
When we did the press conference in London, it was the biggest press conference to announce a live entertainment project I've ever seen. He was so nervous and like really concerned as to what he was embarking on and how people would react to him after so many years. And as he heard the roar of the crowd and started walking up the steps of that stage, he became Michael Jackson again when he walked and took that microphone at the press conference. They were telling him that they still loved him. And I think that was really, really important to him. It underscored the point that he's just a human being.
This is it. I mean, this is really it. This is the final curtain call. I love you so much, really, from the bottom of my heart. This is it, and see you in July.
In the middle of March, we put the shows on sale. We had 2 days of pre-sales. We had the fans register on MichaelJacksonLive.com. 8 o'clock in the morning when we started, it just exploded. Then they went as fast as we could sell them. I guess it was an hour maybe that before all those tickets were gone.
This was at a stratospheric level. This was at a level that we had never seen before.
We sold 800,000 tickets in the United Kingdom. No one's ever done that in an arena. So we still had the whole rest of the world, you know, hungry and waiting.
When the shows actually sold out, there were still 264,000 people in the queue waiting to buy tickets, and that's enough to sell out easily another 50 shows.
Ladies and gentlemen, Michael Jackson has left the building. Well done, everyone, well done.
I said, great, Mike, congratulations. We need to add some shows. He said, okay, I have two conditions. He said, one, I want a house in the country so that the kids and I are not trapped in a hotel suite. I said, fine. I said, what's the other condition? He said that when I do the 50th show, the Guinness Book of World Records are there to memorialize it. And I said, that's it? He said, done. I said, we got a deal.
There have been people that have told me that he could have sold out 200 shows, that there was just, you know, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of folks out there that wanted to see him in concert. Michael wanted to do more than 50 shows. Michael was hoping to travel the world.
If this was going to be his comeback to the live stage after 13 years, it was going to be bigger, better, and more amazing than anything that had ever been done before.
Stand by and dry out chest.
He felt that Kenny would help him really execute his vision in a way no one else could because he understands him so well. And that was the start of the creative process.
And those are the toasters, and they're actually in the stage now, you can see.
Those guys worked on Dangerous together, they worked on History together. It would never have been anyone but Kenny. It's just the way Michael was, and Kenny wanted to do it. It was preordained.
And it tilts, Michael, it goes like this.
Yeah, once you transform at the same time.
Yeah.
I think Michael really believed that I had a real understanding of an appreciation for entertainment and where he was coming from as an entertainer, the value of the audience, and that he could trust me. And Michael said to me, let's put together a group of the greatest artists working on the planet, and then let's do everything we can to inspire them to go to places that they've never been before. And so I set out to invite people that I admired in lighting, production design, choreography, music. And Michael met everybody. And Michael would say, now it's time for us to take an adventure together and go to new places.
Plus the depth of it is very exciting. I mean, I haven't seen that before, this kind of layering going back.
What about your pods? When are you planning for those?
Well, two things. One is to have them high up above the mother grid.
This Is It was Kenny and Michael's dream project, and they called to see if I was available, and I was in Morocco at the time, and I said, I'll be back on the next plane.
It was great to do it again and do it on such a large scale and have all of the sort of top professionals in the industry, you know, available to us.
I would
feel a little bit too appeal to the world.
Yeah.
Michael is such a perfectionist that he wants people that act that way and carry themselves that way. And on his level, you have to be that or you don't be there.
Hello, Michael. How you doing, bud? Good.
You know, he expects you to be at your best. He says, you're here because you're the best. I expect you to be at your best at all times.
And then he would go on to say, now the difference is that I challenge myself the same way.
Now come this way.
For the first time in my life in a long time, I would love to get up and say, I'm going to work, you know. And people walk by and say, how you doing today? Oh, I'm doing great. I'm with MJ. I'm still looking at him, trying to see what can I learn to enhance me, you know? And it was always something good.
Well, what was unique about him is the fact that he worked so hard and he wasn't afraid to get out of the box, as they say today. He wasn't afraid to chase something, to try something, to do something that other people might think was impossible.
Michael Jackson was unique among artists I've worked with in that he was so unashamedly bold. He just wanted to break every barrier and every boundary and do everything new. And other artists, you know, want to do like what Michael Jackson did.
Michael liked to do things big. He would often come up with ideas and we would say, well, Michael, nobody's ever done that and it's gonna cost this much and I don't know if we can do that. And he would go, oh, that's why we gotta do it.
He had this artistic vision in his head and he just was relentless in getting to that vision. But the challenge is to give him what he wanted but still make it somehow work in a business sense.
Crazy, crazy.
The creative process, the actual beginnings of it, really were dictated by Michael. I mean, he's a genius. Money really didn't motivate him. And he was going to do whatever he had to do. Because Michael's vision knows no limit.
He used to always say to me, when the show opens, it has to be like nothing anybody's ever seen before. So that sets you in motion. That's your sort of like, you know, okay, that's where we begin.
I have an idea. Michael, I think we need scratches and white noise and a bit of interference. Maybe not all the way through. Maybe in the beginning.
Yeah, and just
you know, just to sort of like, you know, so the audience is kind of like, what's happening, you know, and you know, what is this accidental? Is this on purpose? And then suddenly that thing opens up and Lightman comes, you know, out. I think we're going to be sensational.
Yeah. Kenny Ortega wanted a pre-show that would create an air of mystery in the arena, so as people were coming into the arena, they would see something about to happen on stage. So we designed a kind of cacophony of lighting equipment and chrome spheres on the stage that were sparking with energy and about to come to life as the show began. Then Michael came onto the stage floating in his suit of light.
Michael came up with Lightman. I think Michael Cotton named him. You know, I remember him talking about, was there a way to begin with an awesome sort of video experience that then transferred to his body?
Michael would be holding the same chrome orb that the audience had previously seen with his own image reflected in it. It reminded him of Hamlet, when Hamlet was contemplating his friend. The context of him seeing himself in Hamlet, to me, just gives me chills, because that's fantastic that he knew that and understood that and felt that was part of the theatrical power that he was presenting.
He really slowly open up each piece, take off his headgear, and then just milk it.
I'm just gonna play the moment.
We're gonna take a pool. I started a board. I said first night he would be there at least 6 minutes. And so everybody started taking bets that it would either be longer or shorter, how long he would stay there. And then he would just point to me and we'd start the show.
For this is that I think we approached it in the way that, you know, the audience is gonna wanna see the quintessential Michael Jackson. They're gonna wanna see the classics, but there's always an element of surprise to a Michael Jackson show.
Are you fellas on your marks? Look down, are you on your marks?
We wanted to come into the middle of the show with some great surprises, and so Smooth Criminal was one of those.
Step back in, boom.
cut. Good.
Cut.
I said, what if, you know, all the, you know, badass gangsters from the old Hollywood movies, you know, were chasing you? And Michael loved that. He said, that's, you know, that's totally like in the line of Smooth Criminal.
And action.
Michael Jackson more or less created the music video genre. It was up to us to make these films as good as anything he had ever done, and that was really the challenge.
Ah, he sees him. It's like a 1,000 feet down.
Yeah, I love it.
Smooth Criminal was incredibly challenging because he was acting on green screens, and he had to do some stuff that was, you know, almost stunt-like.
And action.
The films were a setup, and what happened on stage was the payoff. In the case of Smooth Criminal, Michael Jackson was going to jump right out of that movie onto the stage.
Some of our films were interactive in that capacity where we were playing the screen. Some of them were like, you know, sizzle pieces or pieces that led us into a particular a song, offering Michael a chance to catch his breath. And some of them played as cinematic images, moving behind Michael while he was on stage performing. And so the short films played many different dynamics throughout the concert. They're a big part of it. And he was very proud of the fact that I think we had the biggest 3D LED high def screen ever.
The two sides are gonna roll a little bit out of sync, so I have to do it manually, okay?
Here we go.
3, 2, 1.
Michael just kept stressing, we gotta find the new thing. We gotta find something that's spectacular. We gotta find something that's never seen before. And I was working with Bugsy Haugdahl, our production manager, and we had come up with 3D video, which had never been done in a concert before, never been done with LED screens before.
Wow.
I think I was a little in shock to see it really hanging in the Staples Center. It was 100 feet by 30 feet. No one had ever done a video screen like this, much less a 3D one.
What makes this technology new is that an LED screen is bright enough to cut through concert lighting and give concert audiences the full 3D experience for the first time ever.
When the 3D element came into this show, it added infinitely to the layers of technology that had to be accommodated. So everything that we planned went out the window and we had to start anew because of the filming requirements of 3D.
I'm loving this. Anything that we can get more up in the mountain.
It wasn't just a stage show anymore. It was a show of visual illusion.
Perhaps another bolt of lightning hits it and brings it off its thing and it floats up for like our audience.
We like that.
Didn't you get even closer to the audience?
Yeah.
Do it.
Yeah, okay.
Michael was a big fan of 3D and of classic, you know, horror film. And so, in appreciation of all of that, he thought it would be fun to do a 3D thriller.
Do not show this to anyone. Or I'll have Vincent Price haunt you in your dreams.
18,000 people a night were gonna put on their 3D glasses and have a three-dimensional thriller experience.
Wow.
Look at this, the sword. Chandelier into the camera. Yeah. Right.
We didn't set out to do a better film than Thriller. I don't think you can do a better film than Thriller. So what we set out to do was have fun within the confines of a Thriller concept. So we really took the Haunted Mansion as our starting point. And so that you start with lightning flashing, takes us up to the rafters where a guy comes down a chandelier hanging himself.
Go!
Then it becomes very fun and lyrical, and we have cavorting ghosts jumping about and swinging on it and doing stereo gags in our face. And one of them leads us out the window and into the graveyard proper. And the characters in that, we very much echoed from the original film. People crawling out of the grave, you know, and zombies coming toward camera. As camera's first person pushes through and gets to the stairs, and we think we got through the last of the zombies, and we head up these stairs to freedom, only to meet a giant 10-foot black widow at the top of the stairs. And at that point, we end on a matte painting, and that was then to be the backdrop for the actual live performers that were gonna be the same people that we'd just seen on stage that are now zombing and doing their thing, and then the whole piece plays out.
And then Michael was gonna come out and be revealed underneath the Black Widow. And then elements would go off the stage and into the arena and drop down out of the ceiling. So he liked to call that 4D. Michael Curry, who designed with Julie Taymor, Lion King, and many other tremendous productions, worked with us and created these fantastic human-manipulated puppets that were going to fly over the audience and these fantastic things that were dropping out of the ceiling. And then that combined with Michael and the dancers and the band and the singers and the lighting and a 3D film happening all at once was going to be our, you know, thriller spectacular.
Michael, at one moment, just took it all in and stopped being himself for a second and became a fan and wanted to see how the fans would see it and how they would feel it. And he was very aware of what his fans would want and what they needed.
It fulfilled the request of something no one had ever done before. No one's ever put a live show with 3D in an arena. And to make that part of the Michael Jackson dream world is like, it was just fantastic. It was fantastic.
I have 8 yellow comets, 8 red comets, and 8 1-second by 35-foot silver gerb effects.
Okay.
It might as well have been Circus du Soleil over there. You know what I mean? It was just amazing.
Would you like to see them turned on, Michael? Step off for a moment, Sheena. Yeah, can you turn the fans on?
He took from like his last 20 years of touring as a solo artist, and he found a way to do everything better than what he had been doing. Like, for instance, he had this cherry picker come out of the stage, and Michael would get on it. It would take him above the stage, above the band, out to the arena. You know, so now he's like in the center of the arena, and he's still killing it. He's still on the vocal. He's still singing Beat It.
Just watching Michael's face light up when he was out in the cherry picker and the wind and the smoke, and he just looked so happy and just in his element. You know, he'd be like going over the audience. You could just imagine what it was going to be like. There was going to be a rocket attached to my guitar.
That's cool.
And I think there was going to be a pyro that was set off on the sides as well. It'd been kind of scary, but effective.
Michael wanted a jacket that really burned, so we made a jacket out of Kevlar and worked with the pyro company to make it burn after he'd taken it off and thrown it on the stage.
Let it burn, the lights up. Woo!
All right.
Lights up.
Look at how beautiful these are, Michael.
Those are our shots that we licensed for a couple of things.
Love it. Love it.
And I love our little girl.
We love the idea of the little girl, Michael, like almost like a little henna or something very sort of simple that doesn't take away from her innocence. There's something very, very delicate.
Finding a little moment.
Yeah.
There. Okay.
Yeah. Do you like that? Yeah.
He wanted to make his comeback, and he definitely wanted to be bigger than ever. But more than that, he wanted people to walk away with something to think about and really reflect on. And that was really Michael's vision for this tour.
I respect the secrets and magic of nature. That's why it makes me so angry when I see these things that are happening. I really, truly worry, and I start crying about it. It's like a runaway train. You know, if we don't fix it now, it's at the point of no return. This is it. This is our last chance to fix this problem that we have. That's why I write these kind of songs, you know, and to give some sense of awareness and awakening and hope to people.
I remember we were having a conversation one day, and Michael was talking about, with real emotion, about how he was frightened that, you know, his children and their children weren't going to have a planet that was recognizable to what we have.
Look at this.
They'll
one.
Be floating so much that
I
you
love
her.
I love the light on that.
I love this one too. Look at this. Watch, 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 watch. Watch what she does. Look, 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 watch.
Yay.
Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah.
And the lighting's great.
You got it. You got it.
The lighting's great. Great.
Move on to the next shot.
Good.
Of all the films we did, probably the most important film to Michael was Earthsong, because that carried his message. Michael has sort of been carrying the banner for environmental issues long before it became trendy to do so. He's been sounding the alarm that we're destroying our environment and that it's up to us to do something about it.
Is there a time? We founded this little story together which was just sort of following a little dance of our Earth Song Child in a day, just sort of, you know, playing with nature.
My favorite part was the butterflies, the real butterflies. It was amazing.
Finding ourselves in the precious environment of the rainforest and taking a little rest in a little patch of grass and awaking to find it all gone.
And the metaphor on that piece is that we as a human race, like the child, will fall asleep. And we will, when we wake up, our world will be ruined. So we were very respectful of that.
I was trying to save the last plant because they were burning down the forest, and there was this last tiny plant that I had to save. And I put water on my eyes, like right here, so it looks like I'm crying for the last plant.
At the end of Earth Song, our little girl in the rainforest was going to walk right out of that screen onto the stage with Michael Jackson. And the tractor that destroyed her rainforest and devastated that landscape was also going to make an appearance on the stage. The tractor door was to open and a human being was to get out. And it was meant to carry Michael's message that it's not the machines that are destroying the world, it's the people that are destroying the world. And it's up to us to do something about it.
Want to do a happy ending, you know, this is like a not a happy ending, and I want it burning, and I want it there lasting and burning, and I want us standing there with our arms reached out asking for people to please, you know, grab hold and join us in the importance of doing something about this before it becomes a travesty.
Help us. You must.
Found early on that this is it started to take on all these meanings, you know, and it wasn't just about a return to the stage and selling albums, but all of his songs and all of his short films always spoke to, you know, humanity.
If they say why, tell them that it's human nature. Why, tell you that way, they say why.
It was important to both Michael and I, that we had moments where the audience was alone with Michael and the music without pyrotechnics and without special effects, and the special effect being him.
You could put a spotlight on that guy and just have a piano player, and it would have been riveting. I mean, he puts his whole body into singing a song. The audience gets to see it at a live show. They get to see the passion he puts into a song.
You know, he comes from an era where you really sang, you really danced, and you did it at the same time. No tricks. And you either could deliver your record or you couldn't. I think that's a lost art today.
It was also material that Michael and I agreed it should remain sacred. Billie Jean is perfect. It was a place for him to invent. But you didn't need to change the nature of it. You know, he came out, he put the jacket on, he put the glove on, he had his high, you know, water pants, and you left him alone.
Billie Jean is one of Michael's iconic pieces and performances. Not many artists have been able to convey just as powerful a message through a dance than they do in a song. And I think that he had that sort of uncanny ability to do both.
You couldn't drag those kids away from being in front of the stage watching Michael. They were there every second they could be, glued to him. You know, and he would apologize to them sometimes because he'd say, you know, I'm trying to save my voice. My voice is still, you know, I'm building it back, and I'm not gonna dance hard today. And they were just like, you know, they just wanted to be there.
least we got a pillow. God bless you.
What made Michael, in my opinion, the greatest entertainer of our generation and perhaps any, his timing. One time in the movie, I say, you know, aren't you ready? He's like, no.
Guys, that's the cue. I'm sorry, are we misunderstanding something here?
No, we're not misunderstanding.
We're sizzling.
But he's sizzling.
I'm sizzling.
Okay.
So he's waiting for my point. It's coming.
What he was saying was, I'm going to have a moment here. I can feel it. I already know. The audience isn't here yet, but I know I'm going to want to have a moment here.
I want to button my shirt or my jacket or whatever it is. I want to look around a little bit, play with them. Snap my finger, maybe then, bang!
He was in charge, like an old-fashioned entertainer. Technology didn't run the show. Michael ran the show. And when he stopped, you watched and you held your breath. And that's what made Michael Jackson Michael Jackson on stage and why he was different than anybody else that you ever went to see in concert.
The world should be full of love.
Mm-hmm.
Love.
Mm-hmm.
Love is the most important thing in the world.
Man in the Mirror has always sort of closed Michael's concerts. Michael loved the message of the song. If you're expecting change, it has to begin from within. And that was just something that I think that Michael really enjoyed leaving as a last remembrance of, you know, spending an evening with him.
But he can't leave the stage regularly. He has to do it in Michael Jackson fashion.
We had fun wanting to top ourselves. You know, we had Rocket Man years ago where he flew off the edge of the stage at the end of a concert. So Michael was like, we have to top Rocket Man. What can we do?
Part of the creative of the show was called MJ Air. MJ Air was the only 3D piece we actually viewed at the Staples Center in the 3D screen. It was incredible.
What we're gonna do is have the whole theater rumble so that you felt this jet was coming from somewhere, and then you just start to see a little nose peek in, and then the wing turns around, and the wing felt so like it was over your head. You'd watch people do this, and you could just see that they really felt like the wing was right on top of you.
You see, they don't look that good anymore.
Michael would have sang the last refrains of the song. The entire cast would have climbed up to the top of the stage platforms, and then exited through a stairway that emerged out of the video screen.
Michael Cotton had designed it so that a door in the actual screen opened up. And so that physical screen matched our graphics perfectly, and the stairs came down.
Last person out would be Michael waving goodbye. The video door would close over him.
And then the plane would taxi down the runway, turn around, fly out right over the audience's head. It was just the coolest thing. And that effect would have really worked.
The cast and Michael would be taking a quick elevator down to floor level, be in the cars and out of the building. It's the old Elvis has left the building. You need to get him out of there.
This show, production-wise, blew away anything he's done in the past, and I don't think anybody would have come close to this for years.
Michael is very into letting the show speak for itself.
Seeing the show does the talking.
Mm-hmm.
The show speaks for itself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's how it should be.
Understood.
You know, he goes, it hurts the show when you talk about all of that too soon. You know, so it made sense to me. And that was part of his, you know, sort of intrigue, the mystery and the theater about it.
I don't think there was a better show than what you would have seen had we got over to the UK. I'm convinced of that.
That last rehearsal day was it. We, you know, saw it. We realized it. You know, the goal had been reached, that the show had found itself, and the tone of it, the pacing of it, was all there. It was all there.
Thank you. We're going to stop for this evening now.
We were gonna then pack up everything, put it on a boat, send it to the UK, to London, and he was gonna move over there with his family and with the kids and start dress rehearsals over there. That's how close we were.
Thank you.
It was just really sad, you know, when he passed, because all of us felt so, you know, together and ready to do this, and Michael seemed so happy and ready to put on the show.
God bless you.
I wish he had, gotten to do the first show, you know, gotten to open at O2, because I knew it meant so much to him. You know, he was young enough to do it. You know, his kids were old enough to appreciate it. The fans wanted it. You know, I know he missed the stage.
He was so looking forward to this, so looking forward to doing what it was that he loved all of his life. And no one invested in it more than he. And he was a part of all of it, every bit of it, from the costume designs and choreography and music and vocal arrangements, from the lighting and the scenic, you know, production design to the films. Michael was, you know, the man in charge.
Really, really sad that that the entire vision that he, Michael, Kenny, and Travis had, and we all put together, didn't get a chance to be unveiled as they all saw it as one collective piece of work, you know, the masterpiece, you know, but the masterpiece still in our hearts and our memories, and it can only be looked at as a highlight in anyone's life to have been part of something like that.
We'll just run for a sound check, Man on the Mirror.
Okay.
And then we'll talk about the ending, MJ Air. Your favorite part.
Yeah.
Right?
He loved that.
You know, the fact that we're able to share with the world what that process was like, you know, in the documentary is something I'm very grateful for, because I think, you know, a huge tragedy would have been to, you know, let these ideas not happen.
None of us ever expected to be doing this kind of a film. You know, there were no cameras, you know, on tripods and booms. There was no design. You know, really, it was just fragments, pieces. It's like creating a mosaic to tell a story out of like little pieces that we somehow miraculously were able to put together.
All of the key players in the project were always committed to carrying this vision through, and none of us ever gave up on any of these ideas. Michael was so passionate about these ideas. You know, we all had a burning inside of us to carry them forward.
You know, we did it with love and always with Michael in our hearts, always with Michael in our mind, 7 days a week cutting the picture together. You know, the first thing every day and the last thing every night was, you know, that Michael was ever present. You know, what would Michael do?
I think what we want out of this film is for people to see the real Michael Jackson. For so many years, there was just so much out there that was just so wrong and just so, you know, just untrue. And for people to be able to see him as a person and to see him creating and to see him doing what he does as an artist, that's what we hope people get to see.
You won't get the full production show. To me, you're getting something better. You're getting to see the process of a genius, of greatness, getting an inside peek of something that not too many people get to see.
This was a guy that had really come full circle, and he was really ready to show the world best of Michael Jackson. And that was worth being there every day. And that's what I miss the last time I saw him.
I'm proud to be able to say that I was a participant and that I helped. He trusted me, and it's really one of the great gifts of my life to have earned that trust and to have been able to, you know, collaborate with him and to just, you know, to take part. I mean, there aren't too many people anymore that can drop my jaw, and Michael Jackson remained one of those people all the way until the end.
I will be.
God bless you.